you'll give that Amazon IP.
So why do you like let me install it on the CPU instead of Mac?
So when you see
the server as one of
that's a great thing. Why not use the server at home? If you can run hosting from home, why not? Now, if you are worried about bandwidth and all that, then
is there any other advantage like other than?
So you're not managing your infrastructure, right? That's the biggest thing. Why would you do hosting? For that matter, why Amazon or why hosting?
Yeah.
Run a server from your basement, which is what a lot of startups end up doing, right? But when a disk fails, you are responsible for the disk failure. If a memory stick fails, you are responsible for that failure. You have to do that hardware maintenance for yourself. Right? Do you really want to be in that business, or do you want to focus on the business itself?
And there you may have bandwidth limitations with your local network provider, you've got a home type setup.
Okay, so the answer, quick answer is no. So if you are on a reserved instance, the answer is no. You have to go to another machine. And if you have reserved something for 3 years or 1 year, you are not going to be able to use that reserved instance for scaling up. Now there is other things you can do. You don't necessarily have to go to another machine, a bigger machine. You can do something called as auto scale in Amazon and elastic load balancer. What it does is by a command line, Amazon will fire up more machines for you when certain thresholds of CPU or memory usages are reached. You will automatically spawn a new machine with the required image, and you will have your code and it will auto balance it for you. So that now you have two machines, two web servers, two database servers, and your traffic will be dynamically load balanced. So look up elastic load balancer, look up auto scaling.
But those additional instances, that you need to install WordPress and you need each.
Right, so.
Or do you know of preloaded images with WordPress?
Actually, there is no concept of, I mean, if you ever end up doing auto scaling, you should do something called as cloning of your existing AMI. So this machine that I just have, right, it has the native code for gamesfreepuzzle.com. If you want an exact WordPress code like that come up on another server, you have to clone this machine first. You clone a machine, save it as an AMI, as your own AMI in S3, and you have the autoscaler and the spawn a new instance with that AMI. So that you have the exact code from your first machine to the second machine. Otherwise your machines will be out of sync from a code standpoint.
I agree with that. One of the key features for Amazon is the autoscaler feature, but how do you deal with something like a centralized storage solution as far as like your media uploads and your
S3.
Content?
S3, so I'll show you.
There's also PPS volumes which attach to your local box.
But you can only attach one DBS volume to one instance, you can't.
Correct.
Have multiple instances.
Connected to the
same
media
file, so S3. So I have a bunch of my media files on S3, and I have it in a bucket. I have slash images within my bucket, which stores all my thumbnails, and slash SWF, which stores all my SWIFT files. So if you're looking for a media solution or a content delivery solution, where all your media assets like PDFs, Word documents, they are not delivered from, you want to be on S3 or CloudFront. CloudFront is the full-fledged CDN that you can get access points from Japan if Pacific Asia-Pac content will load those images or SWIFTs. You can have East Coast, West Coast, Europe as regions on CloudFront. You do that.
Does
this is my S3 buckets, loads. Any other questions?
Did you at some point choose between a static IP and an elastic IP?
No.
No?
No. So I do not, do not buy any elastic IPs. If you're just spawning a machine as a web server and a gateway server, you will get an IP that is public.
What are those elastic IPs and pages for?
So I'm not the good person to answer that.
So
I'll give you an example.
We saw this DNS issue, right? Mm-hmm. So if there are a bunch of people pointing to your servers and your IP address changes, DNS refreshing across different DNS servers takes a long time. It takes about 48 hours. So if they're hitting an IP address that doesn't exist, it'll just spin. It doesn't even blow a wall, right? It'll just sit and spin. So if you have an elastic IP, if your machine goes down, the next one that comes up can have that same IP address.
But this, the address that you get when spawning an instance is a fixed IP. It's a static IP. Right? There is no, that's your machine, that's your box. So when he was saying about why don't I run a server from my basement, you could, but you have to get the static IP from your ISP, you have to get a certain bandwidth, and you're telling them that I'm running a web server on an FTP server from my basement. So those are the downsides. So then they bump you up to the business plan or what have you. Right? So that ends up costing you 70, 80 bucks a month. The ISP ends up costing you. Sure, that's true. So the way, so I started the machine, now I have to shut it off. I want to shut it down, I'm done with the demo. So all I do there is select the instance that was on, instance action, terminate, and the machine is gone. I will not have any access to it, the IP is destroyed, all my changes that happened there are all gone. And you can see, this says the system is going off, down for power off. And the machine has been shut off. You can do this where if you see a sudden spike, you can put this manually, bring up a machine, get your code on there, ask your load balancer to have point to this as an additional machine where it can render its content from and shut it down when you don't need it. There are people who can write scripts that automate this whole process.
But are you saying you have to bring up a second machine manually? I thought that the whole point is that Amazon can dynamically create a second machine for
you. If you have elastic load balancing and auto scaling enabled, and if you have written those things, scripts that have enabled you to start them up, absolutely.
Then Amazon will just.
It will automatically keep spawning machines.
A dozen machines while you're getting hit by a day, and then it'll drop back down to one machine.
I have a friend, they run a startup in Santa Monica. They spawn 79 machines every night, automatically, of not one size. They run a small size, a big, large, 35 gig memory machines that they will spawn overnight, process a billion images or so, and then shut it down.
Cut me off.
Okay.
Hope you guys don't mind.
20 minutes of. Any other questions, see me after this?
Thank you. Jack and Watto works.
Alright, here you go.
Oh, no, 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 where is it?
Which set?
Well, the small piece is not the important part. I have to say anything. Sure. Did you get dropped on it?
Let's try to search for super cache. WP super cache. One click. Install it. Create it. And plug in admin page. Clear all cache when a post up. Okay, so seems that caching is enabled. This would also help. So, if you go here now, okay, so this has stopped rendering because I took that off. So I will take this so that we can continue our demo. I'm taking over your time.
No, don't worry, we've got a couple more minutes.
Both are broken. Another thing that I do is someone was showing QFON earlier today. Google. So instead of doing QFON, or say for example, if you were not doing CIFR, which are font replacement techniques either in Flash or in using the Canvas stack, Google has begun the font directory. Say for example, I want the IMFEL font for my logo. This one. Grab the embedding. Go into editor. Header file. site in. Site dash info. Because this element is in site title. And you reference the element that's site title. I'm writing site dash title and A. This should then render the logo in the new font that you got from Google's hosted directory. And update the floor. Select all. Plugin. So overall, let's see if it still shows up or not. No luck in my time. So in this way, you're up and running on Amazon EC2 as a for your infrastructure. And I think this is what the one that I changed, so I'm going to change this setting. So for now, this is what it looks like. This is how this site renders right now. I'm pointing it to my server, pointing the A record of games3puzzle.com to this server. Now, because I will install WordPress in this directory. Okay, it does not exist, so I've not created that yet. So I'm going to say C. Going to give full permissions for now, then I will lock it down later. And I'm going to get I'm getting the WordPress installation file, and it's a GZ file, so I have to unzip it. So So it created a folder, it installed itself in a folder called WordPress. I have to log into. If I had created a password for MySQL, all I would do is have the option -p and hit enter. MySQL minus u root -p. Instead, I will just do it this way. And all I need to do is create a database for WordPress, create database WP3. And I'm done like for creating that. I'm also going to give you should, if you do this, you have to still lock your important directories down after this installation. So I recursively given all read, write, execute access to everything under WordPress. Let's see if the site. Oh, I still need to restart my Apache. I don't think this has the DNS changes are there yet. So let's see what this says. So this works. So the root of the site, I'm ready to install WordPress. Okay? Eventually, this piece will also go there. In the meantime, I will go ahead and create a configuration file. What was the database name we used? WP3. No password. Localhost. Take this. And then install. It's done. Two games. WordPress is installed on your server now. How does it look? Let's see. Okay, this is not rendering. That's your 2010 theme from WordPress 3.0. This site will eventually become that. So, in your control panel, one of the first things I like to do is turn on permalinks, clean URLs. So instead of seeing URLs like ?p=123, I will see my post name. I would then like to install my favorite plugins. All-in-one SEO is my favorite SEO plugin. Admin page to enable it. I can set the title of the home page, description, keywords. I can do it for now. Done. Install a couple of other plugins. Sitemap. Google Sitemap. Activate that. How many of you like the native commenting system that WordPress gives? How many of you use Discuss?
Disabled.
Hmm?
It's permanently disabled.
Discuss?
No, like I disabled the whole.
Yeah, Discuss the whole commenting, so you can take off the commenting hooks. I like Discuss for my commenting system. I don't like the native thing, so if I want to install Discuss. If you want to use the native thing, I'm sure you guys are aware of Akismet and getting an API key so that you can avoid the spam in commenting.
This plugin, apart from like the Facebook plugin, is it render server side, so it's indexed from Google, or is it JavaScript?
It is a JavaScript. I believe the entire content is on Discuss.
Yeah.
But there is, the page will read it, so the bot should read the commenting.
Well, if it's not showing up in the source when you view source, it shows up.
It does, right? So, I'm not going to enable it because I have to. Let's see. I have Discuss on my blog. This is Discuss on my blog. Okay? So let's see how this renders. It's HTML. And it's not an iframed HTML.
If you break open that text, is it there or is it just in a graph?
Okay.
Okay.
So the other thing I know from Discuss, they actually double duplicate content with the comments on their side.
They are not public on their side.
They're not
public on their side.
So
there is no Discuss doesn't have commenting on their side of your site's comments. So
I find it for it. I don't see another index.
There's no index on?
No, I did not see that. That's what I was expecting to see.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh really?
Yes, because it's pertaining to your own blog. Your comments on your blog are not public to the world. So let's see if our site is still doesn't like that, it seems. Eventually the site should change.
You can do a flush DNS. You can do a flush DNS. Might clear your DNS resolve. Your DNS resolve the cache.
Let's see.
If you do it though, you install it on the IP, so it's going to keep redirecting back to your IP until you change the database.
No, my server name and server alias in the site's default is points to gamesfreepuzzle.com.
Oh, it did? Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I did those changes already.
Oh, okay.
So if not, we can. See those? Server alias and.
Oh, yeah, I can't see it. Really,
yeah, so I have that.
That's not really the last one.
No, I mean the host lookup shows that it's updated, so.
So let's do a ping to games. It should be now resolving to this. So this might be a browser cache issue.
Yeah. You can go there and actually, yeah,
you can browser. You can push your local max DNS as well. For some reason,
obviously. That's...
Back control shift.
Control shift.
If you hold down shift and click the refresh button up in the top, it should force refresh.
Oh, that's a Mac refresh for me. I'm doing Mac refresh. Force refresh. Let me try Safari or Chrome. Okay, in this step, in the previous step, I just accepted the default options. In this step, I'm going to create a new key pair. I'm going to call it WordCamp-LN. I'm going to create and download the key pair. And what this is, and I'll show you in a sec. It will give you this key pair. I'm going to say save. It saves it to my downloads folder. Then it goes to the next step where I have to select a security group. What are security groups? Security groups are access groups into your instance. You allow certain ports to be open or closed. I have set up a security group called lamp-fedora. It has three ports that are open. Everything else is shut off. So from an outsider standpoint, SSH on port 21 is open. Port 80 for HTTP, our web server is open. And MySQL on port 3306 is open. That's my security group. I've created the security group, saved it. I'm going to just select it. Review this, and I'm going to submit. Thanks. So you can see I had a machine earlier, I've shut it off. There's a new request for a spot instance that is open. When the spot instance is provisioned for me, this icon will turn green and it will say active. So we have to wait for a few minutes, 3 to 5 minutes. So while we are waiting for that, can I answer any questions relating to steps that I have taken up to now?
Groups. Can I get more granular with that?
Sure. So let me go into the security group setting. So this is your security group setting in your Amazon management console. This is my default security group. Okay, what does this say? MySQL. I have opened MySQL access for this security group. For any machine that I spawn with this security group, port 3306 for MySQL is open for all machines. 0.0.0/0 is keeping it open for all. Similarly, my HTTP port 80 is open for all machines with this security group. And somewhere in there, it might be. There's no SSH in here, so this one is not. One?
Oh, it does.
Oh, it does. Yeah. Port 22 is open for that. I said port 21 earlier, I think, for FTP port. It's port 22. I'm sorry. So, the Fedora, lamp-fedora security group has just basic settings. Any machine on the web or anywhere can access all these three ports and for those services, they map to those services.
Can you just talk quick high level why you would use Ubuntu on the server versus like something like a Fedora port? And Ubuntu is nice for end users, it looks like a Mac kind of. But on the server side, is it better than like a mature like Fedora port or something else?
I'm very comfortable with Ubuntu, and most of my servers have been Ubuntu. Fedora, CentOS, or Red Hat are also servers that are commonly used. Again, I've used this Debian distribution, which is Ubuntu. And again, we are using the server piece of it, not the desktop.
Yeah.
This is not a desktop piece.
Right.
This is a server operating system. So, no, this is a 32-bit operating system, because we are on a 32-bit instance. Let's see. Okay, so we have the instance is provisioned and it is active. Where do we see it? We see it in the instances panel. And we hit refresh. And you see, this is a lifecycle, it's called a spot instance. It has an AMI ID, it has an instance ID, it has a public DNS, it has an internal DNS, and I actually, you had asked me about what is the public IP. This is the public IP of this machine. This piece. 184.72.136.220. You don't need to buy any Elastic IPs or anything. This is assigned to you for the life cycle of this machine. As long as you keep this machine on, this is the IP address for it. So now that we have the machine up and running, we have to log into the machine. In order to log into the machine, you remember we created a key that we downloaded. So the way we log in to these instances is using the key that we created. And in my case, my key is, I believe, in the downloads folder. Let's check it real quick. That's my key. WordCamp LA.pm. Now the way Eric, I think, has set up this instance is it will bark at me if I leave the right permissions open on the key. So I have to shut those off. I bring this up, remove the write and read except for the owner. If I don't do this, the instance will prematurely tell me that, hey, I won't allow you to access this. You have, the permissions are too wide open. So then I'm ready to start the access piece. I'm gonna copy and paste some commands here, and all I'm doing is trying to SSH into my instance. In this case, it's -la.pem, and this piece where it's giving me EC2, I have to use the new name, which is this. And I'm in. This is our machine, and now we have to go on about installing our software to get it up to installing WordPress and seeing our blog there. Going to run an apt-get update, and then I am going to run the package manager so that I can select which software I want to install. I use sudo task cell. Okay, you see the LAMP server, I hit the spacebar. And I'm gonna say okay. And this will install Apache MySQL PHP. And it asks me for a root user password. Obviously, all of you know that you guys should set the password. I'm not going to set this for this demo. That's a bad security violation, by the way. And it will bark at me two more times. Okay, I'm gonna say no.
So the task cell is a wrapper around.
It's a package manager.
Yeah.
It's like your control panel. Okay, one more time. Okay, it's done. I want to see if my Apache is up. I can do it by running this, and you can see the Apache processes are up. And of course, another way to see it. It works, obviously, so that's good. So back to, I'm gonna have to enable mod rewrite. I want to make some config changes to the Apache config files for the available sites. Going to change all the overrides to all. Probably want to. Save this and I'm going to restart this. Okay.
Is there an instance, an image where Power has all this stuff installed?
Well, so as you were saying, there are Fedora LAMP instances, not Ubuntu instance. And there might be a community AMI on Ubuntu that I don't know that has LAMP or anything other than WordPress or WordPress. Very few hands, right? How many of you are very happy with using what using Amazon EC2? Okay, so most people who have it are very happy with Amazon EC2. How many of you have WordPress on shared hosting? So you guys do blog or CMS as shared hosting with some place. Have you run into spikes on your blog and you have run into an issue where the site gives you a pingdom alert if you have set up pingdom alerts that the site is down? That you had a massive gob of traffic coming to your site and your shared hosting account just cannot keep up with it. Okay, so there are people who have suffered from it. And what kind of shared hosting environments does everyone use? So if you can say,
Bluehost.
Okay, Hostgator. MediaTempo. Okay. Anybody uses GoDaddy or? We have a few people on GoDaddy also. So I will tell you my journey, how I even came to this point of doing a presentation on Amazon EC2. So first of all, who am I? I'm Ramesh Goradia. You can find me in these places on Twitter, on my blog, and my site. I am a usability engineer, user experience person. I have extensive skill set in usability, analytics, conversion rate optimization, SEO, how to build in virality in content, things like that. I have love for all things open source. I was doing a similar presentation like the one here at the Drupal camp, just installing the Drupal 7 alpha on EC2. I was introduced to WordPress 4 years ago. I don't get to do this in my day job. I work for a medical device company up in the valley, and none of this WordPress or Drupal things are at my workplace. And I have ended up helping a whole bunch of my friends get up on WordPress and do blogging on it or run a store from WordPress and so on and so forth. And the flexibility that WordPress provided me in terms of being a publisher and being able to do so many things, like installing, say, all-in-one SEO plugin, installing the base sitemap.xml plugin, and getting a good site up and running in no time was a big lure for me to continue investing my time in WordPress. So that's who I am. So Amazon EC2. I actually began a small site on the side last year called gamezilla.us. I have about 45,000 games for kids. I am importing 200 or 300 games every other day on that site, and we do some translation in 45 languages, and so we create this site with all these translations and so on. Where I began hosting that site on Rackspace Cloud. And that is, Rackspace Cloud was, if you guys remember, last year Rackspace acquired Slicehost.
Yeah.
And Rackspace Cloud was a conglomeration of Slicehost, Mosso, which was an in-house web startup of Rackspace, and Rackspace. So they cobbled some resources together, got this new hosting environment going that they called Rackspace Cloud. I was on the basic 256 meg cloud, and I ran into terrible problems with them. Again, this could only be me, where as soon as the PHP's memory usage went above certain threshold, it shut down my whole instance. Without any forewarning, without any email, anything, my machine got shut down. My server got shut down, and then I would get a pingdom alert, and I would have to restart the instance and so on. And that went on for about a month, and I said, okay, let's move to something more reliable. And at that time, one of my friends, who's an expert at EC2, I dabbled into EC2. I started up a box or so back a couple of years ago. I knew what it was. And he said, now it's more cheaper. Because EC2 by itself, if you went for a smallest on-demand instance, you're looking at $72 a month without counting any bandwidth costs. So then Amazon began something called as reserved instances, where you pre-purchase for up to a year, up to 3 years, an instance, and then you have a very reduced hourly rate on those instances. So I went to the smallest reserved instance called m1.small. It's $350 for the instance for 3 years, and then the price falls to about $21 a month, $21 a month, something like that, without costing the, without taking into consideration the bandwidth costs. So then I had also in the meantime begun a blog called educator.com. Funny part was, I have a shared GoDaddy.com account where I have about 19 sites. None of those 19 sites have had an issue, right? And they don't see much traffic. They're probably doing 1,000 uniques a day, if that, each one of them. And I've never had an issue with my GoDaddy account. But for this educator.com, every other day I would run into a pingdom alert of the site going down. And I get more traffic on educator.com than the other sites. But I had the Amazon EC2 instance going for my Gamezilla site, which is a Code Igniter site. And I decided to move my blog right to EC2. That's how I got started on Amazon EC2 and WordPress. So I'm actually going to start the demo. I will actually attempt to do the whole do a whole site on Amazon EC2, and I will show you how I do it. log into Amazon Web Services. It's aws.amazon.com. You can just hit sign in. So while I was doing this dry run last night, I discovered something else that Amazon just launched the day before, was a brand new type of instance. They just launched, I was just talking to a few people here, they launched something called as a micro instance. You have the small instance, which is 1.7 gig RAM and 160 gig hard drive. They just launched something called as a micro instance, which is as which uses as less as 0.7 cents an hour from a costing standpoint. So I'm gonna use, I'll show you how to use this.
Have you actually used those?
I did use it twice since last night.
Because I was chatting with somebody, it was like taking longer than a day to instantiate the site itself.
So we will see it right now. So let's see how much time it takes. I did a demo even a few minutes ago. So I fired up Amazon EC2, and all I did was I'm going to launch an instance. These are the default instances. For people who don't know these, Amazon has pre-built Fedora instances and Windows instances. However, I'm looking to give a presentation on Ubuntu, so I'm going to have to point to a community AMI. I also have made an AMI for myself. I'm not going to use that. How many of you know Elastic.com? Eric Raymond. Okay. So he has done a lot of legwork for all of us for Amazon EC2. He has pre-built machine images, Amazon machine images, AMIs, for us. All you need to do, and they are all loaded in Amazon. Okay, I'm going to take a 32-bit instance of the latest Ubuntu build, the 10.04, and there's an AMI ID. I'm just going to copy that. I'm going to search for this AMI ID in the community AMI section. I find that. Now you will notice that this is of an EBS type AMI. EBS stands for Elastic Boot Storage, Elastic Block Storage. And if you guys need to know what it is, if anyone has questions, I will answer those questions after this demo. So I'm going to select this. And if you look here, this was a presentation I was originally planning on the M1.small instance with 1.7 gig RAM. Yesterday, I saw this. There's a micro instance with 13 MB RAM. And I'm going to request a spot instance. So there are three types of instances. There's an on-demand instance. There's a reserved instance, and Amazon just began something called as a spot instance. The downside to using a spot instance is, without forewarning, Amazon can shut it down for you. So if you cannot run your mission critical apps on the spot instance, but just because we are doing this demo, I can go on a spot instance, and usually it will last for at least an hour of time. They will not try to shut you down in between, but I've heard instances where they have shut down spot instances in between the hour. Now the upside of using a spot instance, they are extremely cheap sometimes. So an on-demand instance currently for the small box is 8.5 cents an hour. A spot instance is as less as 3.1 cents an hour. That's a big upside. This one, as you can see, the micro is at 0.7 cents an hour. And what is my max bid price? I'm going to say 1 cent an hour. So in case the price goes up, I have covered myself till from 0.7 to 1 cent an hour. Okay? I'm going to hit continue.
What was the three times you said it was on demand spot and something else?
Reserved instance.
Reserved
instances, you can reserve a box from 1 year to 3 year period.
Okay.
And for this micro instance, you can reserve a 3 year micro instance for as less as